Well, hello and welcome to session 28 of the 5-Minute Bible Guides. In session 27, we looked at whether the Bible is anti-woman and concluded that it's nothing of the kind. It may not be friendly to some goals of feminism, but then again, feminism, for all its claims, may not always have in mind the big picture interests for all women. In this session, we'll be looking at the Bible's view of family and sexuality. All right, how pro-traditional marriage is the Bible? And the answer is very. In fact, much of what we know as traditional marriage we get from the Bible. But let me be quick to point out that what modern-day Westerners think of as traditional marriage and family may not be exactly what the Bible records. The Bible is clear that God designed family life to be centered around a man and a woman in marriage. However, marriage styles differ in the Bible as to how marriages are arranged and how they work themselves out in daily life. The ancient Israelites practiced marriage between a man and a woman, but it looked a bit different from marriage even in Jesus' time, or even from marriages among believing Gentiles later in the New Testament. Marriages were contracted differently, and the way the role divisions worked out varied a bit from time to time and culture to culture. What about divorce and polygamy in the Bible? You may be wondering that. Jesus addressed those issues in Matthew chapter 19, verses 3 through 9. He said, let me just read the passage. Some Pharisees came to him to test him. They asked, "Is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason?" "Haven't you read," he replied, "that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female and said, 'For this reason a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh.' So they're no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate." "Why then," they asked, "did Moses command that a man give his wife a certificate of divorce and send her away?" Jesus replied, "Moses permitted you to divorce your wives because your hearts were hard. But it was not this way from the beginning. I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another woman commits adultery." So in other words, God designed a one man and one woman marriage. God allowed deviations from that design, not because they're good, but because the alternatives were worse. Human darkness, selfishness, and abuse can so destroy a marriage and other kinds of relationships that it can become impossible to continue. Or there may be a surplus of women in a culture, polygamy, for example, that requires a woman to be attached to a household. I've seen polygamy firsthand in my travels in Africa. In some African societies, women must be attached somewhere. Now, just because that's true and just because the Bible allowed that sort of thing doesn't mean that these deviations disprove the rule, according to Jesus. What about expanded families? It's true that the Western model of husband, wife, and kids that we're used to is only one version of the traditional family life. The Bible records family life much more as most cultures practice it around the world today. Husband, wife, yes. Kids, yes. But grown children and their families living either with the parents or nearby, yeah. Grandma and grandpa may be part of the household along with a niece or nephew, assorted servants, and others who have no place to go. That's more like the traditional family life that the Bible depicts. Okay, with that said, it should be pretty obvious that the Bible does not condone what people refer to as alternative lifestyles. In fact, it's pretty clear that it does not regard them with any sort of favor at all. But here we must be clear about what the Bible does and does not say. While it does not affirm homosexual and other alternative sexual lifestyles, it does proclaim God's great love for people of all kinds, and it offers new and fulfilling lives for anyone who will turn to God through faith in Jesus. Neither does the Bible count alternative orientations as being in some sort of different category than other behaviors and attitudes that displease God. The word that the Bible uses for these types of behaviors and attitudes is sin. Of course, in our times, using the word sin is considered, well, a sin by some people, so I'm phrasing the concept differently. The Bible may not approve of alternative lifestyles, but then it doesn't approve of theft, murder, lying, abuse, self-centeredness, self-destruction, or self-righteousness either. The Bible records that in making the world and the human race, God designed relationships to work best in specific ways. He designed marriage to work best when it involves a man and a woman, and for families to revolve around that union. Have people fulfilled God's design? Rarely. Many traditional marriages are broken, unhappy, and even twisted versions of what God designed. But just because people have messed things up doesn't mean that the design is faulty. Are some people damaged by the poor examples of traditional marriage? Of course, many people are. That's the real tragedy. But the Bible always holds out the hope that people can change and live according to God's fulfilling and blessed design. I've seen it happen over and over again. In the next session, we'll tackle the issue of whether people in our enlightened, sophisticated, and even cynical 21st century should take the Bible seriously. Until then, this is Dr. Michael Bogart for the 5-Minute Guides to the Bible.